turn to pick.
Oh, hello everyone and welcome back once more. We're going to give it another take here as we hop into game two of Vegas Squadron going toe-to-toe against the CIS Rejects here. It's day one of stage two action for Star Ladder Season 13. We already witnessed earlier a doubleheader of OG going against Na'Vi and OG going against Alliance. Those were awesome matchups. I definitely recommend you check them out. But here we go into game two where Vegas Squadron surprisingly down one game against who many would think the underdogs here in CIS Rejects. Coddle Guy for Beyond the Summit, but I'm not alone. I got my buddy Scant back again, joining me remotely in Scant. I listened to it this time, and he at least said Dota somewhat properly the second time. I didn't hear the first time he says it because I'm usually like trying to flip all the switches and move it around. But my goodness, the LAN final. I'm looking forward to it.
It's during the part of the video where various different games are being listed, and like, I think multiple, I don't know if it's the same video, but it's, I think Dota 2 and Hearthstone are both like pronounced very weirdly, but usually the chat knows. But yeah, anyway, you mentioned that it's kind of surprising that Vega lost the first game.
I'm at the
point where I think we need to start asking the question, like, I do think that they were a strong team that deserved to do better at the Frankfurt Major. I think they even deserved to be in TI5 and got very unlucky. I don't know, after yesterday's matches and then today this first game, people keep asking, are Alliance back or Na'Vi back? I want to ask, are Vega gone? are they like, I don't know, like, something's not quite right in the last couple of days for this team.
Yeah, I feel like if I put Vega into, you know, a Royal Rumble with teams like CIS Rejects, Alliance, and Na'Vi, at this point, I don't know who
Vega
would come out victorious between
pick.
Them, just based on what we've been seeing as of recent. And could be as easy as some of the upper echelon of teams have just kind of figured out the meta, that next step. They have answers to all the common problems that teams like Vega used to pose. But now they just don't seem quite as threatening here. And we don't like to pass judgment too fast and be like, oh, they're already out. But yeah, I do agree with you that this is not going well for a team that, you know, were really strong going into Frankfurt. They had, you know, tough matchups there. We already mentioned how they took down the what became champion squad twice, but even now against a team like CS Rejects, just seems to be throwing them off their game. They get a second phase pick Dazzle, which is something we don't see very often though, and they already have tremendous team fight coming together for them. Who knows, maybe a sneaky Huskar could come in the horizon here. Scan, it was not banned in phase two, surprisingly. But there is a Bane already in their favor and a Slardar. So that's not too shabby if something was to pop up.
Turn to pick.
Well, let's just hope that Dazzle has a better game this game than the previous one. I mean, it's not necessarily on Dazzle himself, partially on the draft, how things worked out, but really didn't get much. Hardly anyone got saved by Dazzle in the previous game. They would either die before they got graved or die after they got graved, but they'd die pretty much always. Dazzle had no say in it. But Vega actually reinforced now with the Abaddon as well. So they've got, I don't know, do you say Abaddon or Abaddon? People say it different. Everyone says it differently.
Oh, please, I know. I always feel like I need to pose that same question to people, and I feel like at this point, it's Basil and Basil. You know, some people, the great Gordon Ramsay will call it Basil, but, you know, everybody, at least around here, is Basil. It's Basil. So I just figure it's Abaddon or Abaddon. I don't know. Let's get Ice Frog himself, his first words. Tell me, please. What the hell am I supposed to say? I've heard
Can we just get like a video of each hero like introducing themselves with their preferred pronunciation?
Yeah, right. Like, I'm sure I'm gonna hear about it though through Twitch. Or like, well, according to ancient articles of Dota history here, it's always been the emphasis on the Dun or whatever. But the point here, Scan, I know what we're trying to make is Abaddon is gonna be amazing with this lineup. This was something I was talking about a bit when I was still solo casting at the start today. When you get in a matchup, and we saw Ehome pull it out at Frankfurt in this very same kind of matchup, they were stuck against a Bane and a Slardar. His shield is just very nice to have, and just one of those heroes that
Vegas
many teams, with maybe the exception of like an EG or something, they kind of sleep on the hero and just don't really consider it. But then eventually a team will pull it out, and you realize the guy has a lot of potential. Specifically in lineups like this, I feel like he's an ace grab right now for Vega.
I will say, though, that Ember Spirit is a really good response. In the sense that if CIS Rejects take the game to a point where he gets farmed, now you've got like multiple heroes with no lockdown, and Ember Spirit just like destroys those kinds of lineups. So,
yeah,
I mean, absolutely, Vega's lineup at the moment looks like it could kind of steamroll through CIS Rejects before they even get that farmed, but it's looking like they're on a timer. That's what it's looking like to me.
They don't have enough catch now. This guy's going to be a slippery bandit, and they're not going to have much to stop him, except like a Tusk uppercut snowball shard hope you connect it. But Dazzle and Abaddon, they have no way of locking down. That's where you hope to, you know, sneak in something like a silencer, a disruptor, some way to contain him. But I agree with you. If he becomes a big problem, he gets like an early boot to travel or whatever he wants to do and begins to just farm up, they're not going to have a way to stop him. That could be a bit scary here. So I wonder how they could reinforce this, They're going to be committed now for going for a core. Unless they're having some of that Alliance Kool-Aid there, Scanton. They're going to see about making a core Abaddon. I imagine that this is going to be their mid lane grab here for no one. And with Quap and Shadow Fiend out of the picture, even Windranger taken out. What are we thinking here?
I don't know. I will say that I've actually seen, I can't remember which, but I've seen another team also run that offlane Abaddon. So I think that might be something that starts to trend, although it didn't go very well for Alliance recently. But I don't think any of these heroes are no one's hero. So I think it's got to be no one's hero that's coming last. I'd be surprised. I guess he could go for the mid Tusk. That's something that some teams have tried. It's possible. It just doesn't feel like his style, though. He's usually like more of a, ultimately the one position player. Well, he's usually at least in a position where he can be the one position player.
Oh, of course. It's gonna be tricky though. Gotta offer late game potential and a way to answer this Ember. Or they're maybe trying to backpedal and see what other options were. I was casting that Alliance game earlier. They're like, oh, we really want to get an AA here. Even if it kind of just futs everything else up, we just got to have this hero here. I hope Vega are not kind of in that same predicament now. Nope, they're gonna get a Lina here. So there's always that interesting matchup with Lina and Ember. They kind of counter each other a bit well, depending on the execution a bit. You know, if Ember's caught with his Flame Guard out and you got a Lina with a Yules, an easy Yules will rid of that pesky Flame Guard and allow her to really open up. But if he didn't have Flame Guard out, he can cast it and avoid a lot of damage from Lina. It's a matchup we get to see pretty often.
So I think that at least in lane stage, Lina does really well against Ember, and also actually gets the upper hand against Quap. So that's one good thing going for Vega Squadron right now, that no one's probably going to win mid lane pretty convincingly this game. And we did talk about how they're on a bit of a time, and they're probably going to be the ones making the moves early on in the game. And it's very, very helpful to have a mid lane sloped in your favor when you have that kind of game in front of you.
Oh, I certainly agree. We'll have to see, though, what is going to be the last slot here for CIS Rejects. Already committing with their double cores. We're looking at a secondary support here. Could be a bit more selfless. And maybe something to respond or not allow this Abaddon to be a big problem. And AA has already been taken out.
10 seconds remaining.
Been a significant grab. Maybe themselves get a disruptor for just kind of set up.
Remaining.
Someone who can also make stacks. No, that is a Tiny. That's a Tiny. Is this a support Tiny? No, it's always want to fly Quap. That is a four position Quap right there. Okay.
Support Quap is really good, actually, in the right circumstances, and I think this might be one of those because he's against two enemy supports which don't have lockdown. So it's like you have it's a support that's going to just be like a slow scaling core because it's not going to die, so it's going to get gold. But it can also control tempo early on in the game. Most support heroes can't do that because they don't have that blink with like really long range. So she can get around the back lines, get deep wards up, do all sorts of things, but also harass and gank early on.
Prepare for battle.
All right, it's interesting. We see it occasionally from like your fancy Pycat Alliance squads and stuff, but I've never seen it in a convincing performance where I'm like, that is it, I'm going to see it in my pubs, we're done for. You know, it's just kind of been usually a useful tool or maybe a miss.
Man, I'm one step further. I've like started doing it in my pubs. Oh. I saw Minats doing it, and I saw Aloadon's doing it, and they both did it really well, and then I was like, okay, I gotta do this. And it's worked for me as well. I mean, I'm only playing in like low 5k or whatever, but I feel like I understand the logic behind the support roaming Quap, and I think I understand why they pick it in this game, because like Tusk and Lina are the only control, and if those heroes use their spells on the support Quap, well, then nobody's controlling Ember Spirit. So they're going to have to, I mean, Vega Squadron are going to have to decide in this game, do they want to use their control spells on a support hero? Probably they won't, and probably that means that it's just never going to die in those fights.
Interesting move here. Always want to fly, taking to the high ground here. They don't see each other, but she is maybe hoping for a swoop play here. Could sweep up that room quickly. Not an easy squad to go against here. Abaddon adds deceptive amount of sustain to the team and can reflect back quick damage. Block back here. They free up the ruined spot. Always one fly still waiting for it, but not going to be committing on anything. And oh, look at that. They actually toss Soul to the high ground. He is stranded up there. No TP to make it back out. It will cost Tiny his life. They may also get Always Want to Fly, and they will. Two kills right away for Vega. And poor Solo's just like, come on. Really?
Yeah. It's not worth it, though. He's sending a TP scroll. He'll get out of there. Although they actually, they've fought for the career twice now. Lina wanted to get a healing salt. The career ran back twice, and Solo's like, come on, man. I need to get off this hill.
He's like, I need to play the game.
It's a cute little tactic, but if it costs you deaths, it's definitely not worth it. It's perfectly fine to give up the bounty rune to do it, but two heroes dead, not worth.
And he was able to get the TP. I thought, well, maybe there'll be like some weird reborn map interaction problem where he can't get the map, you know, the TP from the courier, but no, he got it easily, no problem. And it's not like he was in a high ground spot where CIS could easily just watch over it like the other side would have been. So it's he gets sidetracked a bit, but as you said, definitely not worth it. They lost two lives, and now they got to kind of make up for it if possible here. And Mag's already not too threatened in the lane. Does get changed up. He'll be forced to snowball out, but ultimately can walk back and away. Still has plenty of tangos and even a salve to go through if necessary. But do you think the lane of the utmost importance here to kind of get the start here, is it the mid lane setup that CIS are rolling for with this Tiny, or do you think it's more on Vega?
Yeah. I'm not sure which team, but it's definitely mid. And that, honestly, right now, I feel like that goes for most competitive games. The mid lane decides more than any of the other lanes in terms of the lane stage. This game, because I feel like both Tiny and Lina are really important playmakers and both capable of snowballing if their lane goes particularly well.
Mag will continue.
It does. I do think it favors Lina. I mean, if it's 1v1, I think it favors Lina.
Oh, yeah. That's where the Bane comes into play. God Black is going to be like, not allowing this Lina to have too good of a time. Didn't go with the early Enfeeble or anything like that, but can just still be a bit of pain in the butt here. Iceberg is going to quickly snag up a haste rune for himself. And Bane is going to take his business elsewhere, it seems. Chains here on the Mag on the top front. Easy snowball out. And just more harassment. They're forcing Mag to chew through all of his regen now, stuck with only his salve. But still finding some decent levels. And he's 3-1 CS. Not too shabby. Compare that over to the other side here. You have Afterlife, who's at 9-1 CS, and he's actually having a pretty good time by himself. Now he has the assistance of Bane, even.
Bane Elemental's really not a nice hero to play against the Abaddon. You just, like, Fiends Grip someone, and they shield off. He shields off the ulti. I mean, like, it just feels like ulti shouldn't be able to get shielded off. It's one area in which the Abaddon really shows its true strength as a hero. Obviously, that's only much late into the game, but it's also going to take off the Slaughter's ulti. It's another ulti it takes off. And it can take off the Ember Spirit's chains. There's going to be a lot of playmaking potential for Solo, even though he doesn't have the lockdown himself, to just remove and counter the lockdown from the enemy team.
Yeah, that is going to be a lot of weight on the shoulders of Solo so that he can get his team out of any sort of sticky bind. But we'll see. Pasha is still slowly creeping on up here. He's one to definitely get a bit more proactive with his gyro, which, as we say that, he's already kind of getting some trade here with Afterlife, who is knowing the supports are not nearby. He's committing in with the sprint. There's the second crush. It's going to connect, and look at that. He got a solo kill on the gyro. Ooh, just when we're talking about Solo and the pressure on him being around when necessary at time at need, both him and Seymour were kind of busy doing the pull through, and great notice there from Afterlife. He takes full advantage of it and is rewarded with a kill.
And this is the kind of thing you wouldn't expect to happen to a team that's playing on land together. Like, there's some kind of miscommunication where Gyrocop doesn't realize, hey, he's actually in danger because the other heroes aren't nearby. But it's surprising to me, and maybe just hints at there being, like, not a perfectly happy dynamic right now in the Vega Squadron camp.
Yeah, and I remember I checked on Twitter, and they definitely had a picture of them on land right now. And it is interesting. It does make you kind of feel a bit weird for Vega on where they are. They're playing together, having a bit of a tough time here with CIS rejects, but we'll see if they're able to pull this out and take it to a game three. CIS rejects, not ones to back down. They're one of those teams that, you know, they're always going to be the underdog until they really can prove themselves.
They got a lot of talented players. They just haven't had that run of. I think they made the semi-final of one of the qualifiers in the previous season. I don't know if it was ESL or MLG or, but they came kind of close in one of the tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, they kind of petered away, and now maybe they want to be on their way up again. But that's, I mean, my concern is that to be a great team, you have to be able to like fail to qualify for LAN and then just keep going and qualify for the next one. And that's kind of what we haven't been showing yet out of this team.
Yeah. Top lane, here's a setup. They're looking to go for Mag now. Will this squad be able to get it done here? He still has Snowball and Shards. Won't get either off. Gets sapped right up. Bane eats him whole. Seema's on the scene. Gonna have to grave himself here. Free and easy pick right there. I guess he just didn't have very many options, or maybe you just can't underestimate that pure damage of the Bane, man. It just sucks your life literally away.
Yeah, so I would say CS Rejects are definitely outplaying Faker Squadron in the lane stage so far. I mean, the score's 2-2, but remember both the deaths CS Rejects got were when they like went for the, you know, gimmicky shenanigans of the rune, kind of gifted those deaths ultimately. So actual lane play, they're the ones making the kills, they're the ones making the plays, especially in that offlane where Slaughter managed to make a kill, which, I mean, if you just told someone, hey, here's the draft, there's a Gyrocopter, Abaddon, and Dazzle against the Slaughter, they'd never guess.
Yeah, and it's against Pasha, who we know for being a great core player, and it's, you know, Vega, and they're on land. That just should not happen. Oh, look at this mid lane. Iceberg eats a full Laguna. They roll on forward, and suddenly Mag's got a double kill. After they lose two top lane, or at least lose the one, they come back and grab a double for themselves. Beautiful sweep through, debut for no one in his Laguna.
Yeah, and a big rotation from Mag as well, who's going to have a lot of pressure on his shoulders this game in terms of control. We spoke about how the Abaddon, the Dazzle don't really provide any of that kind of disable lockdown. But if Tusk is making the right rotations and making the right calls about who to focus when, that's going to definitely reduce the pressure on them.
Uh-oh. Afterlife comes in, sees that trouble's in their woods. They just took the stacks, that side bank. Afterlife trying to spin away, forces a long snowball commitment from Mag here. He'll eat the stun. Step right back out. And look who's sweeping him from behind now. Oh, Pasha rolls in deep, drops the call down, and they back up it away. Still no one to go down there. Tusk is going to finally get dropped. Everyone, all hands on deck for this one. They're going to be taking down the Queen of Pain, and it looks like that's enough for Vega. Long toss in, does a bit of damage there from Iceberg, and oh, they'll get the sleep. Quickly traded away. Seema might hand over his own life for the save of Lina here, but Goblek still wants to make a go on her. Seema's going to get finished off. He's still on the chase. He has the sap, and he eats a Laguna, gets the sap off, will stay alive and well. Long ball toss puts him in perfect position for a crush, and now the return. There's the snowball and shards as Mag is going to get the cleanup, coming right back from the dead. Now they suddenly turn back. They're getting miscoil off. Solo's going to get the finish there, it looks like, onto Goblek. And finally, CIS Rejects are like, okay, we got to go. We're done. What a bloodbath, though.
Yeah, so complete bloodbath. Lots of aggression back and forth. I do feel like at the start, Vega Squadron made a bit of a mess of it. And again, another sign that maybe they're not all on the same page, which is a bit worrying. Because I don't know if you remember, right at the start of the fight, Mag snowballed in, but he didn't wait to, you know, gather any of his teammates. He just like went ahead on his own, then turned around and ran away, which made me think like maybe his teammates were saying, no, the rest of the heroes are coming from above, let's not do this, or... But they definitely didn't look on the same page at the start of the fight, and sort of lucky for them that the chase goes on for so long from CIS Rejects that they get those two return kills at the end. Otherwise, it would have been a very CIS Reject favored fight.
They somehow managed to scathe out with minimal losses. And now they get back into their groove here. And for this Ember to kind of get that bit of extra space to be a problem towards the later portion of this game, kind of help that there's a bit of pressure here on Iceberg for this Tiny to, you know, start to be a bit of a problem right now. He's got 700 gold. You know, I'm not sure if I'm going to be expecting that insta blink dagger grab scant or an early drums or something, but I imagine it's got to be something to help him get a bit more proactive.
Yeah, he'd love to go for the straight blink, but that's just going to depend entirely on how quickly he gets gold. If he makes a double kill here, he'll probably rush blink. If he dies, he might get something else in between. If they could rush the blink on the Tiny and the Slaughter, it would put them in an excellent position.
Well, they got a kill on Solo here. It looks like the top lane, but we keep eyes on bottom as they have the poor man's blink dagger effect. Toss in crush. The snowball sweeps through from Mag. A brilliant save by him, and now it might be CIS on the turn back, or not. Here comes Queen of Pain. They toss in once more. They get a good crush, but the shallow grave is going to be there here from Seema, and Now looking Pasha alive. He looks a step back and away. Afterlife hiding in the tree, staying low. They end up getting him down. Still call down going to be coming off. That means Iceberg's going to be going down. Pasha gets him from the grave.
And here comes the Ember Spirits. They're in trouble still.
He's pissed off.
He changed his mind. He's not going to go that deep.
Well, well, well.
How did Afterlife get to where he is right now?
I don't know. He was hiding and lurking around the corner there. Got off an amp and it looks like he just kind of blinked himself. Or not even blinked himself, but yeah, I guess he was just hiding in the closet.
He was hiding.
Yeah.
Okay.
Looked like he was really deep in there, but yeah, he just found a nice little nook to fit himself into. And now he awaits orders on what's next and could be at mid lane. No, it's not. Back the other way. Solo. Gonna be caught between the two of them here. But they know he's in a bad and they don't like that. And he's level 6 now. Not really worth the effort right now.
Middle tower is under attack.
Yeah, it is one of the advantages of having an Abaddon as a support, that usually when enemies find a support, it's just quick pick off. This hero, if you chase him around, try and actually complete the kill, it's just like asking for trouble, because you're going to take so long to kill him, teammate's definitely going to get there.
Yeah, you might even eat a bit of damage, almost as like Venomancer effect, where it's like, oh, you'll jump him, it'll take a lot of effort, but it'll probably pop off his ultimate, and next thing you know, you're all almost dead, you got to go back to base, just so much of a hassle. Abaddon could be the kind of same nuisance to a lot of teams, and he gets kind of free will to do as he pleases, whether that's optimize, make shot, you know, call shots, put wards down, be ready with a TP, whatever it may be. But they're back at farming. We'll switch over to the net worth now, and you could see Lina at the top for Vega here. Yules, I imagine, is in order, but still needs a bit of time.
Yeah, Mag making a rotation to the mid lane. I think Mag's done really well so far for Vega. There was the one fight where the team looked on different pages, but I don't think that's on him. I think he's mostly been in the right place at the right time, and it helps compared to his previous game on Earthshake. It helps when you're the Tusk that doesn't need that Blink Dagger, that could just get mobile and control the pace of the game without that many items. And I think so far he's done a good job, definitely, and his team would be in a much worse place if it wasn't for him.
Some attention from Vega now in this mid lane here, but looks like they're not going to follow through with anything. It's all about getting the next item in order here, as Afterlife will continue to push towards his Blink Dagger. Iceberg did step off, got the Power Treads for now. We'll see if he's going to be able to opt for the Blink Dagger next, or if it's going to fit the bill as far as how they decide to dictate the pace of this game. And they decide to get a bit more proactive. It's not going to be easy, though. You got someone like Lina on the other side who's getting closer and closer to this Yules. Laguna doing serious work. Do you think it's pressure on one more side or the other to try to just get more done at this point in the game, where they should be taking advantage of them peaking and being better?
I don't know. It's actually complex, this game, because in the previous game I said that CIS Rejects had like so many things, initiation, control, etc. But Vega could outscale them, and I feel like in this game, CIS Rejects maybe have the better of both of those things. The big advantage Vega have is the reactive power. I mean, they kind of had a last game, but it was a bit too passive, the Earthshaker, Dazzle, and Shadow Demon. With the Dazzle, Abaddon, plus Tusk, I think it's slightly more... There's more potential for creativity from Vega Squadron, but I do feel like CIS Rejects, if things don't fall apart for them, are looking pretty good. They've got lots of stuff to control fights, but they've also got the Ember Spirit that we spoke about so much at the start, which is going to mostly be unimpeded later on in the game.
Oh, they found Dazzle, and he is gripped, tossed dead. Well, they might lose Goblack Ford here. They will. Laguna comes out from no one, and Vega are angry. They sweep in, but Iceberg is already out the other way, avoids the call down. And they continue to make chase here. They want Tiny. He's going to hide up into that closet and TP out from trouble. He'll be good to go. The nearby Ember Spirit just in case here. Uh-oh, Ember, though, going into lane, has a Remnant, and he's gone. Good thing no Yules was there or anything. Even then, might have been able to kind of etch out from trouble, but better to be safe than sorry.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
So, always when a flyer's hit an important level, that level 6 on the greedy, slightly greedy roaming support Queen of Pain, often a very big deal, because, I mean, it's a big deal on any Queen of Pain, but when you get to it on a support hero, you've got that burst damage for a fight where if Tiny were to catch someone, or Slaughter were to catch someone, or even two people, and follow up with a Queen of Pain LT, that can be really devastating. It's not, you know, the burst AoE damage that you expect to see from a support level 6.
Mag is in trouble here. Gets jumped on, chained down, sliced up, and now is in a bit of a sticky wicket here, but hey, he lives! The shield comes out, he continues to hold, but finally they bring the pesky Ice Walrus down. Cost him a lot, though. Always want to fly, forced to bottle up quite a bit. Now they're looking to turn the table here onto Solo. Still has borrowed time. He's a pain in the butt. They trigger it. Now they'll chase him. This is the ghost ride right now. But they can't do anything about it. So, what is he doing? He is still happy to take a fight. He knows help is on the way here. Always want to fly back. Doesn't have a ton of mana, but does want to participate. All the meanwhile, Lina going to get a kill on Slaughter, but we'll keep action here as we'll see them back out in a way. But the kill was actually over on the bottom. They took out the Slaughter there. Lots of juggling action, though, between the top lane, too.
Yeah, and it finishes Lina's Yules, which also really important to deny Slaughter's blink, which she was just about 100 gold away from. Tiny's also really close to blink. And it's going to be a crucial timing. Getting that Yules just before the two blinks. I think they'll probably get to the blinks anyway. And then it's kind of going to be... I don't know. To a large extent, it feels like first move advantage when you've got all these key items. Like, if Tiny and Slaughter blink on you before you react, you often don't have time Radiant's to react. They have got the heroes. Attack. They've got the Abaddon and the Dazzle and the Tusk. But, you know, if the burst is that quick...
Yeah.
It feels like that happened last game. They had the Dazzle and Shadow Demon, but often they're just like... Heroes just died before they could even do the saving.
They quickly realized they didn't sign up for this. They were not hoping that it was going to be that difficult to keep cores alive with that much burst on the other side here, but they might not have much of a choice. They're inching in bottom lane, Vega is, to try to take down this tier 1. Sayas Rejects waiting nearby, still no blink on Afterlife. Probably doesn't want to commit too much, would love to save his money right there. Bottom lane, though, that's where they're going to get mag. Look at this, Ramzes able to kind of inch on in and take advantage of the lone Tusk and... Oh boy, sidestepping the call down here. Very angry Nainpasha is going to scare him away, but not be able to get any sort of catch.
Super close. If the cooldown hit him, then he's almost certainly dead there, but just edges out of the first rocket and saves his life as a result. And that's going to buy the space and time as well for Slaughter to finish his blink now. And I think that is the final piece of the puzzle for CIS Rejects in terms of getting very aggressive.
See Vega now coming together here. They smoke up. They are ready to go to work. They still have Laguna in their pocket. Mid lane, though, they make a committed jump for Solo, and that's a bad things right there. He's just happy to get the borrow time off, and he'll be A-okay. Still kind of baiting him in a bit. Vega thinking about going. Iceberg will have the mana back for possibly the combo now. Amidst his toss, I think Vega want to engage. No one sweeps in, gets the Yules. And this could be the end here for Iceberg. Oh, what a sleep, though, comes out from the Bane, but it's not going to matter. He will end up going down. Jump in. Three-man crush from Afterlife. Follow up. Sonic Wave. Beautiful stuff here from Sayas Rejects, and they're buying back. They want to fight here. Vega see the buyback, and they're having second thoughts. They're looking to double back now. Oh, they got the one chains on the Seema here. Do Sayas Rejects want to over-engage? Doesn't look like it. Now their one's back, and now Vega's moving back in. They're like, we're going to get the Yules onto him. Jump in. Crush. They get a Fiend's Grip off, but it's going to get canceled quickly there. They will end up losing their Ember Spirit, and now it's Vega back in control. Look at them scooping everybody up, and they saw the Queen of Pain in the trees, and they're going to finish her off. Oh, big fight for Vega now. They just kind of manipulated where the fight was going to be and pulled it right back into their arms and re-engaged once more.
It's such a contrast to the previous game, because exactly what I was saying didn't happen in the previous game. Did just happen in that fight. CIS Rejects don't burst anyone down quickly enough, and so all the healing pays dividends. But at the end of the fight, you wouldn't even believe that CIS Rejects had been casting spells because the Vega Squadron heroes are all on 4 HP. And I think that mostly goes down to the fact that Vega Squadron started the fight. They burst on the Tiny, hardly did anything, and if they're making the first move, the value of those blink daggers is greatly reduced.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Well, are they able to follow it up with a lot? You know. Tier 1 mid is down. They can't really move in for Roche at this moment, but they're feeling Dyer's like they still want to take a fight. No one holding on to 2k now, and we'll see if he's going to be one to go for the Hags or if he's also going to be all about that Shadowblade party. We'll have to see, but for now him and Solo will do work on the bottom, and maybe we'll see a response here scant from CIS Rejects. They're smoked up, moving in bottom lane now. Charged up, ready to go, and they want to say, screw you, Solo. We're going for the lady. And she's able to get off the Yules with the help of the shield. Sleep going to be taken off. Sleep going to be returned now. And, oh, he gets rolled on in. He gets the Laguna off. Will ultimately go down, but can they still get the most out of this now? Mag tossed back. Look at this. Iceberg alive and well. No, going to get dropped right there in the end. Mag going to get the finish. Now they're both going to get crushed up. Goblack. Commits on in. What's happening mid lane? Looks like they want to engage for Seema. Seema caught out and alone here. No grave. He will get chopped apart here. Meanwhile, Bane gets the finish onto a Oh no, Abaddon, sorry, gets the finish on the Bane. And there's the finish on the Seema mid lane. So action breaking up both sides. Yes, Reject recognize that they have the opportunity to get a pick on the mid lane. They get that one, but Scan, what about the first part of this now? Breaking out in the bottom lane.
They're actually punished. And this is repeatedly now, it feels like what Vega were going for in game one that didn't work is actually working for them right now. They've got these defensive support heroes that can really punish you for overextending with your aggression, turn things around. And Abaddon doing good work, keep Lina alive. Tusk comes in, puts in a snowball, she gets her ulti off. There's a lot of work, and this is a familiar style or approach the teams take to deal with very aggressive opponents. It's just that usually we're used to seeing Vega as being one of the very aggressive teams, not the team that adapts and plays reactively to the aggressive team. So maybe that's actually part of why their form has been a bit shaky recently, that they're investigating new approaches to the game. Invisibility.
It's valid. Valid thought. We'll see though. Ramzes with an invis rune here, scoping out top lane. Gonna not know that he just happened to swing by the Vega troop heading up there, but will cross pass with Mag. Gets the quick chain. Snowball's gonna be forced out. He's dragging him up and over closer towards his team here. As always, when a fly is gonna show up. Mag trying to sidestep. Can't avoid the Sonic Wave though. He goes down. A call down comes in from Pasha. Not gonna connect onto anyone here, and always wanna fly. Should be able to just make a hasty getaway with the help of a blink. That's a hit and run job. A successful one there for CIS Rejects.
Yeah, in this game, we do see the Lina going straight into that Aghanim Scepter. None of the Shadow Blade business. I mean, not as big of a lead, so not as much potential snowballing, although this gonna make an attempt on Ember Spirit. This is very difficult. Basically can't make that kill if he has a Remnant up.
That slippery fool. Gonna make it. Backing away, and Vega will just take this opportunity instead to come together now and push down this mid, or sorry, not mid, top tier one tower. This opens up some jungle opportunity here. Do we have any wards on hand? Solo? Nope, no one has a ward on hand, so that's a shame. Could move up into the high, you know, the CS woods and plant some wards and give some vision, but while they see top being pushed in, they're like, this is our chance. We're going to go in with the help of this amp damage and quickly muscle down this Roche. It's proven to be a bit of a tough time, though. They'll definitely need the help here of Ember Spirit, but even Ember doesn't offer too much crazy damage. And look who's already here! Vega! Oh, this is not good. CIS are not going to be able to do this. They got to get out.
Well, I think they'll be lucky that they could get out without any deaths, but do they possibly give up the rush now? If they do, then that's almost as bad as if they had gotten some... It's worse, actually, than if they had gotten a couple of deaths.
Vega just like, thanks. We're starting it. Ours now. Oh, what is happening?
Oh,
oh no. Nope. That's not the all-star play you were going for there, Afterlife. And he goes down just a little late. Ambitious. I applaud his efforts. Apparently he bought out beforehand. He's going Midas. Okay. All right.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. I suppose, I mean, the alternative is usually the 4-star. Maybe figuring that he wants to keep scaling, the game's gonna last a while, and he's not gonna have space to actually farm creeps on the map, or to slaughter, doesn't really naturally do that anyway.
Yeah, maybe they could just defend out. I mean, always want flies going for an Ags. He'll have sonic waves coming out of his ears to try to keep back some of these waves. Soul is trying to keep back some pressure mid lane all by himself here. Now he's caught between three. All black. I don't know if he wants to commit any sort of ulti here on just solo. Borrow time is going to get popped. Tower is going to get destroyed from Bane, but this comes as Mag was able to TP in. And they will be stepping back and away. But all the meanwhile, they're able to get a lot of push time bottom lane and top.
No one actually TP'd in, burnt his ulti on Ramzes, but didn't quite kill him, and then he just decided to leave. It's like, oh well, didn't kill you. Time to go to base. Is under attack.
And Ramzes with those boots of travel is going to be all over the place. Looks like he heads back, heals up now, and will continue to farm up. He is, you know, might be feeling a bit more pressure now that this game is going to be more on his late game presence now as Vega are creeping in with a bit of a turnaround. We look at the net worth graph now. Barely over 2k. At that moment, though, you could see a quick finish from poor little Solo. Borrow time not even going to happen.
Victory Sonic Wave.
They really want to make sure that Sonic Wave didn't happen.
Yeah. He's actually, speaking of Sonic Wave, always wanted to play, and nearly has a Aghanim Scepter, which is, again, it's...
Yeah, they got the kill on to Ember. This time, was not able to remnant away from the Yule's combo follow-up. And Tiny was coming in from behind, hoping to get some revenge, but no one is not going to have any of it. So this time, he comes up and gets a better time. You said last time, he, you know, fell a bit short. Now he made proper calculations or something and got the kill.
I'm pretty sure that's like close to impossible. That if the Ember Spirit's like trying to jump away for Lena to actually catch the timing, maybe there's like a tiny little interval that no one can get exactly right. But without seeing it, I would guess that the Ember Spirit like messed something up. I don't know.
Oh.
Like Lena's don't typically try to kill Ember Spirits with Yules. Tower is under
attack. No one was fishing for a Yules right there. Couldn't find it. Dyer's put to sleep for his trouble as Vega will continue to pressure this tier 2 mid lane, but kind of like what we saw from the other time.
He's fishing for the courier. He's going to go back.
Oh, he's not going to get it. Yeah, I think it's like kind of the opposite from what we saw before. CS rejects know they're not going to be taking really a fight until it's necessary in their base, which could be coming sooner than later. Walk in, they clear out the wave as fast as possible. Still leaves a couple here, and they're going to be able to go to work on this tier 3. What are they going to do about it? Just tossing in, ridding of some shields here. But Pasha with that Aegis, happy to stand strong in the front and do work. Put the step is enfeeble, helps a bit. The flat cannon though is going to work now. And look at this, poor little Goblax. He's eating so much of the damage. Tier 3 down now. Zaz rejects. They gotta think about doing something here soon. Oh, a toss back play here on to Pasha. They're going to get the catch with the Fiend's Grip. It's very deep if they want to stop this Bane, but he's able to make it back it away. How fun having the Abaddon on your team. And now they step back. Two-man Crush will connect here from Afterlife, and they fire back. Sonic Wave is out. Two already go down from CIS, and oh, man, they toss back the Ember. He's able to remnant away, but now he is the lone survivor here. No one, and I mean no person, will go down from the side of Vega on this one. And they will quickly clean out the mid-set of racks, and it does force out a buyback here from Iceberg. Could be the final hurrah, though, potentially for CIS Rejects. But Vega, huge, huge win for him.
Yeah, the Abaddon and Dazzle showing their secondary purpose in this game. Firstly, early on, they were winning fights by reacting, and the Tusk as well. Just like stopping CIS Rejects from bursting people down. There's a. Oh, Lena and Embersburg going head to head in the top lane. Ember just jumps out. Okay, that was just a little bit of teasing. But yeah, going back to the point about Dazzle and Abaddon, really make it a lot easier to force high ground. Often we see teams, even when they're ahead, lose fights when they're trying to push the enemy high ground. And a big part of that is that the enemy team can spam them down and then initiate when they're not 4 HP. But there was no points in that fight. Gyrocopter had an Aegis and he was 4 HP pretty much the entire time. He's just standing there hitting the building. They spam things and he gets healed just as quickly as he gets spammed.
And his potential for being able to be a demo man is not going to stop as he farms through a sweet stack here. His damage will continue to grow. Ramses will do his damnness, though, to keep the pressure back and away. They're down a set of racks, but still confident that they got late game potential. And opportunities will present itself. They will continue to truck on and farm. Ramses just got the next tool in his belt with that battle fury here. No one, though. Look at him. Scoping out the scene here with this Invis rune. He's going to make a go for Afterlife, and he's going to get the job done. He put himself in a position far away from the Tiny, near home, and some friends. And he'll walk away with a quick and easy pick.
Yeah, in the meantime, always want to fly. Desperately trying to finish his Aghanim Scepter on that support Queen of Pain. Needs 100 gold more. Not sure that it's going to be... I mean, it definitely helps defending the high ground because you can use the shorter cooldown means you can use it in like the first barrage of things and then have it later on in the fight. But I don't know if it's like enough of a big deal to change the dynamic from the previous push. Like your serious problem is Tiny. Right? Look at Tiny. He's got half the net worth of Lino Gyrocopter.
Yeah.
He's just basically not even on the board.
Yeah, we need a bit more from this guy right here. Especially if you're a CIS Reject fan right now. You're hoping that he will be able to kind of step it up here. Add some pressure on this tier 2, but trouble is coming in. Oh, an early Dazzle. Weave is out, and they are ready for a tussling right now. Vega are moving into the high ground now. And CIS Rejects, we'll see if they'll be able to stop him here. They'll try their damnedest. They get the sleep on the solo. They hope for the burst on Gyro, and they get it. All while he's a-snoozing. They get it done. Fiend's Grip onto no one from Goblack in the high ground. They can't stop him. Snowball will sweep him up. They hover on forward. They're going to get the kill and always want to fly. She did already commit what she needed to do, though. And now they're looking for a go into Mag. It looks like they might be able to get him here. Yes, they will. Moving up. They want more. No one. Preemptive Grave going to be here. They stop him with the shield. But they toss him up and down. Self Yules keeping alive barely, but Afterlife already looking on the next target. Gets the kill on the Seema. Four down all day. They're hungry for five here. Look at that. They're even TPing to the mid lane. Oh, Slardar went the other way. Figuring Solo was going to jive to the right, but he went left. And look at that. Scant, would you know it? CIS Rejects just held wonderfully, and they got one of the biggest net worth swings we've seen this game.
Yeah, I think that the acquisition of the Ags on Queen of Pain actually made a big difference. Mostly just their confidence. It looked like the way it was. Is Solo going down as well?
Uh-oh.
He's in jungle.
They caught up with him. Oh, this is the worst. No swap. It's like you're going to get caught. They chain him down. Help is here, though, and... Okay, CIS Rejects, like, we're not going to press it too far. It'd be nice to say we five-man wiped him, but we're not going to go crazy.
So in the previous, in the mid-push, it looked like CIS Rejects felt they needed to spam people down before they went in. Part of that is that Gyrocopter had the Aegis, which he didn't have in that top push. But I think another part is that they picked up the Queen of Pain Ags, and they were like, we've actually got the burst damage. And they went in with a pretty clear plan. Bane Elemental runs in, sleeps Abaddon, Radiant's, and then they just burst on the Gyrocopter. Those are really the two different factors. The previous time there was an Aegis on Jarrah, and there was a non-sleeping Abaddon. And I think maybe it is a bit on Solo to try and position in a way such that he can't just be slept by Bane, because he's got a very important job to do. He has to be able to take off some kind of initial disable on the Gyrocopter so that he can get his BKB off immediately.
Oh, stun is a swing and a miss from Iceberg trying to make a jump on the Dazzle. Was suspecting him to run straight. He cut left. That opportunity is going to be gone, but I agree with you, and I wonder if it's something that maybe they consider getting something schmancy, like a, you know, a Lotus Orb at some point, just to secure Solo is going to be there with the proper defense necessary. But what's happening over here? Ramzes is happy to cut the wave here right under the nose of Pasha. Knows he has a way out, and he is just going to do what his damnness to prolong this game so CIS Rejects can make a comeback in, I guess, what you can call like the fourth quarter.
Yeah, and this is what we talked about like early on in the game, and we're getting to the point where it's starting to matter. There's not really great tools on the side of Vega to deal with Ember Spirit, and the more farmed he gets, the bigger it's going to be a problem. For now, it's just he can split push really hard, not really worry that much about dying. In fact, I think he's only died really in fights in this game. I don't think he's like been caught out and died, and I don't think that's likely to happen, to be honest.
Yeah, especially not here on out. Maybe kind of stubbed his toe getting caught out that one time from the Lina, but not looking to let the same thing happen again. But as I say that, oh, turns back chains after the LSA misses. He gets the cleanup on the tower. It'll be fine.
Oh, you're right, yeah. That one Lina time, that's still a huge puzzle to me. But I mean, in theory, the later the game goes, the more it's going to be Ember Spirit,
oh, yeah,
like, deciding what happens.
Oh, looks like they got a catch on Solo here. Set up with a sleep. There's the stun. Sonic Wave, borrowed time, and they all take a moment for prayer. But Mag says, nah-uh. Rolls in, picks up his buddy, and says, we gotta go. Rolls Solo out of the way, forces Goblack back with a punch. He goes, look at that. Okay, I don't know. Fiend's Grip cancels it. Says, nah-uh, we gotta do this. No, we're not. They want to run back and away here. And Vega looking to engage. Pasha leading out the charge. Looks like he might get called back here with a call down. He's trying to sidestep. Please don't see me walk into the woods. They saw him. And he'll go down. God, he barely was able to try to creep away, but couldn't make it out. Very awkward fight right there. Maybe a bit of miscommunication from mostly the Dire side there. They wanted to engage, and they second-guessed it. Unfortunately, this does look like it will lead to Vega picking up a free Aegis.
And this is so huge because, remember, one of the reasons that they could defend the base top is just because there wasn't an Aegis stuck at mid. Now there's an Aegis again. Maybe this just spells another side of Rax. The time we saw CIS Rejects successfully defend involved bursting down Gyrocopter, and now, forget about the Aegis, there's also Abaddon's probably not going to get himself slept again. He's got a Solo Crest, he's got his Vlads, there's the Dazzle, he's got the Grave
Radiant's
and the ulti. And there's actually just so much to keep Gyro up.
Well, here comes a test here for CIS Rejects. Can they hold once more? Sonic Wave, everything they can to stop the wave from getting into the fountain, or getting into the base, rather, and leaves Pasha alone up in the front with that Aegis in tow, and he's going to get some work done on this tier 3. Slight start coming out from Ramzes on the side to get some of that backstaff a bit. Iceberg has picked up his ag since then, hoping to cleave down some damage, but as we can see, he's not really able to get in there and right-click anything except a wave. Goes into man mode as he hits level 16, and we'll see if Vega are going to give it a second swing in this bottom lane.
Yeah, this is looking a lot more like the mid push than the top push at the moment, and I don't know what CIS Reject's plan is to be. Maybe they try and go to the back lines and burst someone else down. I just don't see them bursting Gyro and then winning the fight. Yeah, they're going around.
They're back in again. This tier 3 to drop here, but look at the flank play coming out from Rejects. They're looking to swoop in from the left-hand side, and oh no! Swoop right into a Yule's. Afterlife is going to get annihilated on that one. The Slardar is going to be down. We're going to be forced to buy back here on the low ground. Big call down drops in from Pasha as he steps on forward, looking to crush Iceberg here. Mag on the side, getting Fiends gripped up from Goblack. They're going to get the finish, taking out Iceberg, and now Pasha's looking to go back in. Goblack, though, has the Glimmer Cape, going to be able to make it back in the way, but Afterlife again, it's a dieback for him as he gets caught out and taken out once more. No one sets it up. Back-to-back kills onto him. CIS Rejects lose 3, and it looks like they're going to be losing another set of racks here. That's game. And we're going to go to a game 3 skip.
Yeah, and it's really interesting because Vega took the same approach, roughly speaking, in both games. So we're gonna like count on your aggression, have the tools to react, heal, save, counter, engage. Didn't really work game one, worked really well in game two, and very interested to see if they take that same approach in game three of just picking multiple healers and defensive heroes.
All right, with that said, we're gonna get ready and hyped up for a Game 3 match here of Vega versus AS Rejects. With that said, I'm Kyle Guy, that's Scant. When we return, it'll be Game 3. We'll see you soon.